And now I'd like to introduce our presenter. Peter Robin is a regulatory review engineer at American Certification Body. Peter is a TCB for the FCC, an FCB for Industry Canada, or IFED, an RCB for Japan, and a notified body for RMTTE and EMC directives. Peter's experience as a notified body and certification body is a potent part of our certification team. Peter has been reviewing FCC applications since before the TCB program was created. He is well known in the European community as past chairman of the RMTTECA. Peter has been working with MIC matters since the inauguration of the Japan-EU mutual recognition arrangement. Peter's past experience includes EMC, radio and safety testing, and certification for test laboratories and manufacturers. He has been in the industry for more than 20 years. Peter provides worldwide services to our global customers from his office in the Groningen area of the Netherlands. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and hand this presentation over to Peter. Hello, Peter.
Hello, good day to you all. Let me just see my presentation. Can you, Christina, can you put my presentation on there? Oh, yeah, it is. So
it's there for you.
Okay. My name is Peter Robin, and today we are going to talk a little bit about radio modules in the context of the Japanese radio law. Fortunately, in Japan, the method and requirements for having a radio module certified for use in Japan is straightforward. But there are some differences which should be taken into account when you certify a module and when you actually integrate it in host equipment. So a radio module can be certified if it can be tested in a standalone configuration in accordance with the full requirements of the radio law. So the concept of a module approval does not exist in the Japanese radio law, just as it doesn't exist in the European Radio Equipment Directive. However, Japan has defined radio equipment as equipment which can be certified if it complies with all requirements of the radio law. And that includes radio modules. There's no exemption of testing. If it complies with all the regulations, you can certify a radio module. A radio module must be certified in combination with at least one antenna. This is not very much different from, let's say, the FCC requirements. The FCC rules also require that a radio module needs to be certified in combination with at least one antenna. The only difference is that where the FCC has some allowances for integrators to use antennas of the same type and with equal or lower gain, in Japan, the certificate you will get for a module is only valid for the specific combination of radio module and antennas as covered by the certificate. So you cannot easily, just like that, use a different antenna when you integrate a radio module inside a host if it's not on covered by the certificate. So obviously, for radio modules with integral antennas, like a chip antenna or another type of integral antenna, like a strip antenna, this is not really an issue. It becomes a bit of an issue when you have a radio module with a connector to which a external antenna is connected. Then you can only choose from the antennas as listed on the certificate. Trace design antennas are also allowed in Japan, and you basically need to submit the same information about the trace antenna on board if as the FCC requires. If you have a radio module certified for the requirements of the Japanese radio law, then you also must label it with the certification mark and certification number, which is issued by the certification body for Japan. This is kind of an issue because Japan is very strict in their requirements regarding the labeling. If they see a module which is not marked with a certification mark and certification number, they automatically consider the radio module as not being certified. There is just one exception, but we will get back to that a little bit later. So when the radio module has been certified, you can integrate it in any host equipment without additional testing or certification. So this is also slightly different from the regulations in the EU and also in the US, because there you need to do at least some verification testing if all the radiated spurious emissions haven't changed. But in Japan, they do not have such requirements, so you can put it in any host equipment and there's no need to do some additional verification or testing. There's one exception: if you have a host product where you use radio modules, like cellular radio modules in a host product, possibly combined with Wi-Fi or Bluetooth modules, and if the product can be used at a separation distance which is closer than 20 centimeters to the body, then you need to do some additional testing, and more specifically SAR testing. I have some slides about that to explain what this means, because it also will impact the certification of the whole product. So just as an example, here is an overview of some cases you could encounter if you have a host product where you have a cellular product installed, a cellular module, and a Wi-Fi module, and you can use the device within 20 centimeters of the body of the user, then you need to test body SAR. If you have just a cellular module installed but no other module like Bluetooth or radio LAN, then also you need to test body SAR on the final product. If you have a product which has just a Wi-Fi module installed or a Bluetooth module or a combination of modules or low power devices, then body SAR measurements are not required. And this is also slightly different from the regulations in the EU and in the US and also Canada, obviously. So if you only have what I call low power modules, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, BLE, you do not need to test body SAR in any case. So what happens when you combine cellular modules or licensed modules with unlicensed radio modules and the device can be used within 20 centimeters of the body? In that case, a new certificate and certification number for the whole product is required. This does not necessarily mean that the existing certification numbers for the modules are void, but you need to have a certificate which covers the full end product and which also indicates that the product complies with the SAR regulations in Japan. In such cases, the certification bodies need to carry out a limited assessment on the combination of host product and radio modules. that considers the RF parameters of the modules. In the case where a new certificate or certification number is required. This means that a certification body does not necessarily need to fully recheck or fully assess the individual modules where it concerns compliance with the radio law. This approach may vary across certification bodies. Personally, if I assess a product for SAR, which has multiple modules, I typically would like to see also the certificates of those certified modules and wherever possible, the actual test reports. So the new certificate for the radio law will then list all the parameters of the radio modules which are integrated in the host product, and it therefore covers basically the host product and the radio modules which are integrated in the host product. The certification mark and the new certification number then must be placed on the host product. So this is an example of what happens in such a case. If you have two modules, each having their own certification number, then the technical specifications like output power, frequency range, etc., will be noted on the new certificate in full. Those numbers will not be noted on the new certificate, but all the specifications are covered by just one certificate, and it also lists the SAR value which has been obtained by testing the full product for body SAR. And eventually you will get a new certification number for the full end product, and that's the one which is in this case marked by RCB 777, and that's the number which will be placed on the new certificate, and that's also the number which needs to be placed on the end product. Does it mean that the manufacturer of the end product is still responsible for the technical parameters of the modules? No. The existing certification numbers will remain valid to the extent that the integrator still must check if it complies with the specifications, where those specifications may affect the SAR value. So you need to check, for instance, if the output power is still the same as originally tested. And you might want to check if the frequency ranges are still the same, etc. But the end product has its own number, and for the performance of the end product, the manufacturer of the end product is responsible. So in Japan, you have three types of SAR regulations. The first one is for base stations, the second one is for head SAR measurements. Obviously, if you use modules inside a device which you can operate close to the head, like a mobile phone or any other device you can hold close to your head during operations, you also need to perform head SAR measurements. Although in Japan, this is rarely mentioned because they assume that you will not use a discrete module inside a device like that. And you have the body SAR requirement if you can operate them at a distance closer than 20 centimeters to the body. That requirement is relatively new because it has only been in force since 2014. So the body SAR is not a requirement, as I've shown before in that table, for specified low power radio equipment such as Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, RFID, etc. and either operate standalone or in combination with each other. This is kind of different from regulations in the EU and the US, because there you need to actually assess end products for body SAR, mostly under simultaneous transmitter conditions if these exist. But in Japan, there is no requirement. They apparently assume that you cannot exceed the SAR limit in the case of low power radio equipment. If you have a licensed device inside combined with Bluetooth, then you need to evaluate body SAR, and you need to evaluate it under simultaneous transmission modes if it exists. Radio equipment is exempted for body SAR measurements if the total average output power is equal to or less than 20 milliwatts. This is kind of the same as in the EU. And the reference standards are the well-known IEC 62209-1 and IEC 62209-2. The test method for body SAR is the same for the EU and Japan. The tissue parameters for body SAR measurements are the same for the EU and Japan, and these are based on head tissue parameters. And in the EU and Japan, the parameters are the same for head tissue and body tissue, because both the EU and Japan consider this to be the more conservative approach regarding SAR values or the measurement of SAR values. If you use the body tissue parameters as prescribed by the FCC, then these are not acceptable because they, in theory, yield lower SAR values, and as such is not considered as a conservative approach. Having said this, quite recently the FCC has given the go-ahead to use also head tissue parameters for body SAR measurements for the FCC, so it depends a little bit on if you can use certain test results from FCC SAR measurements, except that the limit for body SAR in the US is measured in 1 gram of tissue, and for EU and Japan it's measured in 10 grams, so you cannot directly declare compliance with the limit for body SAR in Japan if you have performed body SAR measurements for the FCC and where head tissue parameters were used. The limit for body SAR in Japan is the same as in the EU. It's 2 watts per kilogram and 10 grams. So basically, since the method is so similar between the EU and Japan, a EU test report should be acceptable for certification for Japan. And I'm saying should be acceptable because it highly depends on the modes of operation and the orientation of the product during SAR measurements. Japan is a little bit more strict in measuring SAR on just more than one side, or the worst case side. But in principle, a test report for the EU can also be used in Japan, and vice versa. Sometimes transmitters can be excluded from simultaneous transmission conditions. There are some examples given here. Although in reality, if you look at the output power values, these values are quite low. So this is more a theoretical approach than a practical approach. Then we have the cannot be opened easily requirement for those who have also attended the seminar last week. This will look familiar. This is a specific requirement of the radio law for radio equipment, and the radio law states that you should not be able as a user to open the radio equipment in an easily way. There are exceptions for antenna configurations or antenna connectors, but typically the requirement is it shall be housed in a single cabinet and you should not be able to open it easily. For a module, this sounds a little bit strange, because in reality a radio module does not necessarily has a cabinet, although you can consider a screen across the transmitter part as a cabinet, and then you can comply with this requirement by having the screen permanently fixed to the PCB, for instance by soldering. If you have modules which do have a cabinet, you can have several solutions to meet this requirement, like special screws. You can weld the enclosure or glue it, or in some other way, such that the device is not intended to be opened. What's also allowed is use a method: if you open the enclosure, things get damaged, and then you can no longer use the device or put it back together again. If none of these requirements can be fulfilled, then the key components must be fixed or covered by glue or some other substance which would prevent access to the components. The background of this is that the radio law is quite old, so this particular requirement was very useful when you still had discrete transceivers or transmitters, where you could manually change the tuning of filters or the tuning of frequencies, or where you could manually adjust the output power. Nowadays, it's very rare, especially in modules, to have such manual means to change the behavior of the transmitter. Nevertheless, this requirement still exists and must be met in some way. The most pragmatic solution, obviously, is to include a shield, because then you do not need to cover any components with glue or any other substance to prevent access to those components. So this also means, by the way, that there is no specific requirement in Japan to have a metal shield over across the components of the transmitter. Japan doesn't have any radiated measurements to verify if all the spurious emissions are still within the limits. So they are apparently not very concerned about unwanted coupling between the module and the host equipment. The shield is optional, but if you have a shield, it will help mostly to meet the requirement for cannot be opened easily. You also need to label radio equipment, and there are some specific notes about the labeling of host products. This particular regulation has changed a couple of times. The first one was issued in 2014. At that time, it was voluntary to label the host equipment with the certification mark and number of the module or modules. Then there was a period where the labeling on the outside of the host product was mandatory, and as of February 2019, that has been made voluntary again. And this obviously excludes products where body sound measurements are required, because those products have their own certification number for the whole product. And for those products, you need to actually label the end product with the certification number of the new certificate, which includes the body SAR. So it's no longer mandatory to put the certification mark and number of an embedded radio module to the host product. And there are a couple of voluntary methods where you can actually put the mark on host products. The strange thing is that in the past it wasn't allowed to put the certification mark and number of a module on a host product, because it would suggest that the product as a whole was certified. But in the meantime, there is a very accessible certification database, so anybody can check whether the number reflects on the host or if it belongs to a radio module. So the first method is that you check the certification mark and number on the radio module, and then you attach that mark and number in a conspicuous place on the host product. The second method is to use electronic labeling. If the device has an integral screen, you can display the certification mark and number on the integrated display. Or if it's possible to use an external display with a wired connection to the radio equipment, then you can display the certification mark and number on that external screen. The user manual needs to contain instructions of how to display this mark and number. It also must be included in the manual that it will be electronically displayed. One quirky thing about this particular Japan regulation for electronic labeling is that if you use electronic labeling, then the certification mark and number must be displayed on the display prior to the first activation of the transmitter of the radio equipment. This only applies if you're using an external display. If you have an internal display in the radio equipment, then this is not necessary. Then the user can just follow the instructions in the user manual. So what we would have here in as a picture is, if the module has a number, what they say is the user cannot see or confirm if the device as a whole is covered under the radio law. So that's why they now allow to affix the certification mark and certification number of the module to the outside of the host product. The note that the user cannot confirm the conformity mark when there is no labeling on the outside is important. So while this is a voluntary requirement to put the mark and number on the end product or the host product, there is something in Japan which you should be aware of, and that is that MIC in Japan, on their website, warns against what they call illegal radio equipment or bad radio equipment or anything else in that same wording. And they have a lot of questions on their website with answers relating to the presence of the certification mark and number. And as you can see, there are questions like, is it illegal if the technical conformity mark is not affixed? Everything just points out to the fact that there is something wrong when a user cannot actually see a certification mark and number on the product they intend to use. So just a step further, because this is particularly for foreign-made radio equipment, and as you can see from the questions on the MIC website, and weirdly enough, this is one of the few parts of the MIC website which is fully translated into English. So this same page is also available in Japanese. This is one of the pages they have fully translated to English. What should be of note here is that they particularly mention foreign-made radio equipment because that appears to be an issue in Japan, and apparently MIC more or less stimulates the notion that foreign-made radio equipment may not comply with the radio law. For instance, if you look at question 32, I purchased foreign-made radio equipment, is this illegal? So those are not really the questions you want to receive as a manufacturer, and if your product has not been made under a Japanese brand name or brand mark, these are just publicly available questions for any person in Japan. So there's also a question 37, why are foreign-made products no good? Well, the question itself predicts the worst, except that the answer is a lot more nuanced, but they specifically warn people when you buy let's say non-Japanese radio equipment, you have to be very careful and you have to check if the certification mark is there. So the point being is that while it is a voluntary requirement, this concept of voluntary has more weight in for Japanese products than for products which do not have a Japanese brand name or are not made in Japan. So anyone who wishes to sell products in Japan based on popular approval should strongly consider to put the certification mark and number on the end product or on the host product, just to avoid any of the such questions as shown on the MRC website. When you look after that question, you see a specific poster of MRC. I included this just to give you an indication that the word foreign made or foreign standard is quite a hot item in Japan, which makes it particularly important to show that radio equipment which you export to Japan can be clearly be identified as being certified or certified for use in Japan. This was for the host product, but if you the radio equipment is the actual module, and the regulation for labeling in Japan requires that you put the mark and certification number on radio equipment, so you also need to put it on the module itself somewhere. There is no longer a minimum diameter defined for the certification mark, but it needs to be recognizable. You do not need to use a magnifying glass to actually observe that it is the certification mark or read the number. And I suggest that you would use the minimum requirements SGSSC has, which, if I remember correctly, is a 4-point font size, unless you have some kind of font which is still readable if you make it smaller. Some equipment is excluded from this requirement, which are implants or temporary implants, or in the case where it is unreasonable to display the mark and number on the radio equipment, for instance, small hearing aids. And this can also be translated to modules. If you have a module where it is virtually impossible to fit any kind of marking, and such modules do exist, then you must display the certification mark and certification number in the user manual, and you need to also place the mark and certification number on the packaging or container which you use to ship the modules to the integrating company. The full certification marking looks like this. The first part is the actual certification mark. Then there's the boxed R, which indicates that the certificate or certification number is valid for requirements under the radio law. If you have a module which also falls within the scope of the telecommunication business law or the TTE law, then that R is replaced by a T to indicate telecommunication equipment. This is an issue for, let's say, cellular and radio modules. Then we have the first three characters of the certification number. That number is the identification number of the certification body who issued the certificate for either the module or a end product which required body SAR measurements. Those are three numbers, and based on the number you can see who actually certified the device. The last six characters is a registration number or certification number which is created and issued by the certification body itself. So here we see a very distinct difference with, for instance, an FCC ID or Industry Canada ID, where the ID for the FCC or Canada is based on a registration number of the company. Here the registration number is for the certification body. And where you can choose your own suffix in for the FCC ID or product code, and you can do the same thing for Canada. In Japan, that particular product code or certification number will be determined by the certification body. This has a small catch, because it does mean if you have a permissive change on your radio module or on the product for which body SAR measurements were performed, you need to go back to the original certification body to have the permissive change processed. So ACB, for instance, can only process permissive changes for certificates we issued ourselves, but we cannot process a permissive change from a different certification body, either in the EU or Japan or in the US. This is the more detailed drawing of the ITEKI mark or the certification mark. I have this one available in a scalable vector graphics format if somebody is looking for it. So as explained, the format is certification body number, product code or certification number issued by the certification body, but also the certification number and mark needs to be grouped together. So you cannot put the mark and the number on different locations on the device, like the mark on the top and the number on the bottom. That's not allowed. What you can do, and I go back a little bit, you can position, for instance, the R and the certification number below the certification mark, above it or on the other side. You can also break up the certification number a little bit so that the first line shows the identification number of the certification body, and the second line shows the actual certification number. I would not go too wild on this, because sometimes it's the certification number becomes a little bit unrecognizable. But there are ways to move the components around of the full marking. The most important thing is they need to it must look like they belong together, so that it is clear that the number belongs to the certification mark. There are some other requirements or recommendations where it concerns the labeling of host equipment. So Japan has a similar text like the FCC has to indicate that there is a certified module inside the host device or end product. You can put the text in Japanese on the product or the host. It's a voluntary requirement. If you would only show the certification mark and certification number, that would also be okay. If you want to be really, really clear to everybody what you have done with the product, you can also add this particular notice, which simply indicates there's a certified radio module inside. You can also put it in the user menu. This one is not voluntary. If you have 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi equipment, then from 515 to 525 gigahertz and 525 to 555 gigahertz, the operation of the device in question is only limited to indoor use. Indoor use does not mean use in a car or a vehicle. It really means indoor use. And in such cases, this particular notice needs to be prominently displayed on the end user device or the host equipment. This is a non-voluntary requirement. And if you have some variations, you can use one of these if you only support one particular frequency band. So, as you can see, the process is relatively straightforward. There are some unusual issues, like the voluntary markings, which in some cases are not really voluntary if your radio equipment is not made in Japan. But that's more from a commercial point of view than from a technical point of view. So basically, this is the process. I have included some links which mainly point to the English versions of the MIC MRA workshops. In those workshops, which usually take 2 days, there are always some very useful presentations about the state of affairs in Japan regarding the latest developments in the radio law, if new types of equipment will be included in the radio law. For instance, 5G equipment is a popular topic nowadays. Sound measurements will be discussed, and I just have supplied you with the links for the last 4 years. There are more if you want to really check it out. These presentations are also available in English for the most part. Occasionally you will see one which is translated only for half the pages or half the slides. But nevertheless, there's a large number of documents in English which could be helpful to determine of how to deal with the Japanese radio law in Japan. So this concludes this presentation for today. So I have some time in case there are any questions regarding modules. I see.
Hey, Peter.
Yeah.
It looks like I've got a couple of questions here. First one that came in, like in the US, is modular approval in Japan optional?
Yes. Yes, if you have a product which includes a module, then there is no mandatory requirement to only certify the module. You can certify the device as a whole. What you can even do is if you actually have a certified module, you put it in an end product or host product, then you can also certify the whole product. You will get a certificate for the whole product, including the radio module. Depending on the certification body, the certificate will also note the fact that there is a radio module inside with a specific certification number. This will effectively be a very limited assessment depending on the amount of information which is available from the certified radio module. It's not really sufficient to base a approval or certificate for the full radio equipment just on the fact that a certificate exists of the module. Personally, I would expect at the minimum the actual test reports on which that certificate is based. That doesn't mean that you will review everything page by page or number by number, but there at least needs to be some confidence that the configuration in which the module is used in the host device is identical to the module as it has been tested separately. And I mean with configuration, mostly in terms of output power and antenna configuration. So yes, you can request whatever you want. It's not really necessary to have a module always tested.
Okay, great. Looks like I have one other question here. What are the actual test requirements for specific transmitters? Where are they found?
Last week I had a presentation which explained that in detail. So I don't know who asked that, but perhaps I'm not sure if you. I think we provide also copies of the presentations to everybody. So if we do, we can provide you with a copy of that particular presentation.
Okay. Yeah, I believe that was covered in last.
Yeah.
In September 3rd. Yes, I'll definitely make sure that everyone gets a copy of that as well. If they want.
Yeah. Because for the ones who actually looked at it last week at the presentation, there are quite a few similarities with this one and the other one, especially in terms of labeling and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have both presentations, then the question of where to find the requirements and what to do can hopefully be derived from that first presentation. And if not, you can always send me a question.
There you go.
By email.
Exactly. Yeah. So here's another question for you. If you're using a version of a previously approved antenna with an integrated cable, but the cable length is just increased, is it considered a different antenna, requiring a permissive change?
That is a very good question. I would say that it depends on how the device has been certified, because obviously the length of the cable will affect the gain or directivity. It will lessen the gain. If you change the cable, if you only change the cable, I would say, in my opinion, that would not be a reason to request a change of the certificate. Because if you change the cable, it would imply that the cable on both sides, on the transmitter side and antenna side, is interchangeable. So as long as you keep then the instructions of the manufacturer, that you perhaps can lengthen the cable, if the original defined cable is too short, I don't really have a problem with that. It's even better if module manufacturers, in case they do actually define a antenna in combination with their module and where the cable can be replaced by a different cable, that they would say so in their user manual or installation instructions of the module. And as long as that's clearly described in the user manual, it's no problem. and it would be a very good idea for every module manufacturer to submit such a user manual with such an instruction at the time of certification of the module, because that means that if you make the cable longer, it would be covered by the certificate, because it doesn't really affect the type and model number and manufacturer of the antenna itself. It's a little bit different if the antenna actually is fused with the cable, because then things get a little bit more complicated, because if you then order the same antenna with a longer cable, the part number will change, and that could be an issue in some cases with the certificate. So it's always recommended that the manufacturer of a radio module uses as flexible language in the installation manual as much as possible, to make sure that you can make such minor changes.
Okay. Looks like we have a few more questions flowing in here. I guess, again, on host-specific devices, here's one that asks, if the host device integrated with a multiple non-licensed certified radio modules like Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, LoRa, can we say that the host verification testing is not necessary?
For Japan, host verification testing is never necessary, regardless how many modules you put in there. It's only necessary if the device is subject to body SAR measurements, then you will need to do something, but it is not required for any device where the separation distance is 20 centimeters or more. There is simply no host verification test defined in the radio law, because the module is the actual radio equipment and that has been certified. Japan does not have any apparent concerns with unwanted coupling, intermodulation, etc., etc.
Okay. Here's another one about the module. If a module does not have any shielding on the RF portion, can it still be certified as a module?
Yes, it can. The only thing is that you then need to make sure that access to the amplifier or other components determining frequency, output power, are covered with a substance which would prohibit changing these components, modifying them. And I know that this is kind of a silly thing to say in nowadays module market where everything is heavily integrated. But if you would ask MIC or certification body for Japan, they would simply will say it's the law. But a shield is not required for Japan. There is no rule which prohibits the certification of a module without a shield, because frankly, all the measurements are conducted on the antenna port. And in those cases, if you have an integral antenna and you test it radiated, then there's also no issue. So, you can certify a module without a shield, provided you can meet the not easily to open requirement.
All right. Let's see. Does Japan require in-country testing? Do they accept the test reports from foreign test laboratories as per Japan standards?
Okay, good question. I have heard this before. One thing, no, in-country testing is not required. In some cases, specifically if you talk about the latest technology, latest cellular technology like 5G, I would recommend that you do in-country testing for I'm not going to say political, but sometimes it's better to do that, especially if a Japanese certification body needs to certify the device in question. In-country testing is not required. It depends on the it depends on the certification body if they accept test reports from outside labs or not, regardless whether where they are in the world. Since last year, there has been a small change in the system where certification bodies need to notify certificates to MIC. So MIC has a publicly accessible database where you can type in a certification number, and then you can check if the device in question actually has been certified, and the database provides you with some basic parameters about the certificate. So nowadays, if test reports are accepted from labs which do not belong to the certification body for Japan, then a copy of the test report will be published in the MIC database. This, in some cases, has had the effect that some Japanese certification bodies are very reluctant to accept foreign test reports, as they call them. So it depends a little bit on the certification body if they accept a test report as is, or if they need additional information such as accreditation, which by the way is voluntary for Japan, or any other information to justify the test results in the test report. There are also a lot of certification bodies outside of Japan. There's a mutual recognition agreement with the EU. So in the EU are a couple of certification bodies for Japan. There's also an MOA with the US. So also in the US are a number of certification bodies for Japan. And that also implies that testing can be done at any place as long as the lab can actually perform the testing and is familiar with the Japanese regulations. But you do not need to go to Japan or have the equipment tested in Japan. That's not prohibited by the radio law.
Okay.
Whether they are obliged to accept a foreign test report or a test report from a third party lab, that's a different question, because that approach can vary for each certification body depending on their personal confidence in a specific test lab. Sorry. Yeah, go ahead, Christine.
I think we have time for maybe one more question, yeah?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, this one's kind of a two-parter. So when a host contains licensed and unlicensed pre-approved modules, what tests need to be performed, and would all the testing need to be performed again?
If you put a licensed or unlicensed module in one host device, which can be used at 20 centimeters, within 20 centimeters from the body, you only need to do SAR testing. Obviously, for SAR testing, you need to test output power values. So that's basically the primary measurement you need to do. You do not need to do anything else if the certification body has access to the certificate of the modules and the underlying test reports. If you have a product which can be used at more than 20 centimeters from the body, then basically you just put your modules in there and that's it. There's no additional certification required. If you choose to voluntarily certify the end product with the combination of modules, then again, the certification body will most likely ask you for copies of the certificates of the modules and the underlying test reports. And in most cases, especially where the antennas are used, covered by the certificates, in most cases, it would be relatively easy for a certification body to issue a certificate for the whole product. But typically, measurements would not be really required, although this can vary between certification bodies, depending on the source of the module, depending on the test reports, I would imagine that you could ask for some spot checks on output power, perhaps some spot checks on band edge measurements, but there is no requirement that everything needs to be retested again in full.
Wow, okay. So it looks like we're pretty much out of time here, but listen, if we didn't get to your question or you have other questions after we've ended this webinar, please feel free to send your questions to us. I'll make sure that Peter receives any questions that we haven't answered. Thank you very much, Peter, for taking the time out and doing the Q&A session about these modular approvals.
Okay, thank you. No problem.
Our next upcoming webinar is covering wireless modular certification for Europe, the Internet of Things and other applications, a week from today, September 17th at 1 o'clock, same time, Eastern Standard. If you haven't already done so, please be sure to visit our website and you can register for the webinar if you're interested. Just a reminder that a copy of this presentation or playback of this presentation will be sent out to everyone. I will also include last week's, that's September 3rd, for the testing and approvals for Japan. And I think that should do it. Once again, thanks, Peter. And on behalf of Washington Labs Academy, I want to thank everyone for their attendance. I'm going to go ahead and end the event. And I hope everyone enjoys the rest of their day. And be safe, everybody. Thank you. Bye.
Yeah, bye. Thank you for attending, and bye.